still very much your Primetime Africa, with our special guest, Dr. Shaye Kennedy, publisher, City People.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
It's so nice to have you up in here.
I feel excited.
Thank you. City People is celebrating 25 years. It's not an easy thing.
Yes.
You have to deal with
stuff.
A lot of stuff.
But wait, you are more than 25 years in journalism.
Of course.
Just 25 years of City People.
Yes.
You have to start from the beginning.
Yes. It's worth it. Wow.
Yeah. That's enough. Give us a bit of your background, your beginning.
Okay. I was born in Ibadan, and I started my education in Ibadan in those good old days. And I went to Remo Secondary School for my...
Are you serious?
Yes.
All my brothers.
Okay.
RSS.
Yes.
Shagamu, yes.
Wow.
I was there for my secondary school education. And from there, I went to Ogun State Poly for my A-levels. Of course, I didn't finish before I left for Ife, where I read history, political science and international relations. Of course, while I was there, I started writing articles. Of course, most of the things we were being taught in class were things that you couldn't see happen in the country. I mean, all the political issues, you could see that those in power are not... and that got me excited. I started writing articles on national interest, foreign policy, things like that. And thanks to the editor of Sunday Tribune at that time, Sir Fulolamiti. My house wasn't too far from Tribune in Ibadan. So I would go there, just trek there. And one day I asked to see him, I saw him, I spoke to him, and he said, fine, why didn't I start writing for you? So that's why I started writing for Tribune in my part two in Ife at that time. I had a regular, every Sunday I had articles in Tribune, and that got me excited. And of course, from that point, I knew that journalism was what I was going to do. Then, of course, I met the likes of Riepu, Dele Giwa, then I met Yakubu, the Newswatch guys at that time, and I got close to them. And of course, that also further made me know that that was what I was going to do. And of course, I had stints with them. All my vacation jobs, I used to do Newswatch. But of course, along the line, we lost Dele Giwa. To the bomb incident and all that, and of course I couldn't continue the relationship. And of course, after I finished in IFE, I served in the lorry. I was with the Herald newspaper, and I also served at Kwarapoli. It was called Kwarapoli in those good old days. Okay. Then from Kwarapoli, I came back to Lagos and I started working with the media. I started with This Week magazine, belonging to Prince Unika Obaigbena. This Week would now became This Day.
Okay.
And all that. But I was part of the early guys, the panel staff in This Week. And from This Week, I went to the African Concord. I joined the likes of Bayo Luga and the team, who were all the Concord at that time. Then, of course, after a while, we had issues with the Concord. We all had to resign, and then we left because we did a story that led to the closure of the Concord. And the late Bashirou Abdulla requested that we all write a letter of apology that he would take to the then president.
That's what the room was saying.
And we just said no, we could not.
The apology, yes. Because you believed in what you
were writing, yes, because we wrote about Nigeria, I mean, the bad economy, everything, all that. We had articles, and we said we believed in what we wrote, and of course, we had to leave. Then, of course, from there, we went to The Guardian, joined The Guardian, and then we started planning the news magazine.
Okay.
So, all of us came back again and set up the news magazine. But shortly after we started the news, that was also shut down, and then we went into Temple, and there was...
You see, when you say shut down, people need to know why.
Oh, okay, that's
you
true.
See, I mean, our young ones, we need to tell them a bit of this history.
I agree with you totally.
You know, they don't know where you've been, where you're coming from. Yeah. So when you say shutdown, they might just say, well, maybe the company went bankrupt. They won't know that, okay, you wrote one story, because everything that they write now on internet, that they abuse Buhari, abuse Jonathan, we couldn't do 25 years ago.
That is true. That
you could not then write anything. They will come and pick you and your parents in your house and shut you down.
That is true. You're right. Because at the time we started the news, we couldn't sleep at home. We had to like leave our various homes, and then we were operating on the ground. After about 2 or 3 years, it was really bad. I mean, the only thing we had going for us was our cars, because we used that as...
But what made you keep writing those stories? It wasn't like journalists were not paid.
No.
So what was the motivation?
I guess it was passion, actually.
For better Nigeria.
Yeah, better Nigeria, and we were very young at that time. We just felt, this country can be better than it was at that time. And of course, money wasn't like the way the country was.
To extend that question, the first story you wrote, it was for Nigerian Tribune.
Yes, the Nigerian Tribune.
How much were you paid? How much were
I wasn't even being paid at all. I wasn't paid yet. Every Sunday. I was so excited that that for me was the only people that paid at that time was the Guardian. I think it was 20 naira. Also, if you wrote an opinion article in the Guardian, it was published, then you got to pay them 20 naira.
Not 20,000.
No, 20 naira.
Not 50
So what people used to do is you wait for about 4 or 5 of the articles to gather the money together. So that was it. Then, of course, with Tempo, I was made the editor, and I was with Tempo for another 1 or 2 years before I left to start up City People. So it's been journalism all the way.
Being an editor also is a chance for you to make more money.
Oh, yes.
Editors of today, if you ask how much are you being paid now by the publisher, you find out that the money is not much. Mm. But if you now take a microscopic lens, and of course, let's see how rich, you find out that the editor is rich.
Yeah.
Can you explain that?
Well, I guess it's an industry thing. It's not something that you can explain logically like that. I mean, I guess it comes with the territory. It's something that you, again, I guess...
Now, editor, we know in will.
That's what I'm saying.
All of them have been away.
That's what I said. It comes with the job itself. Because there are opportunities, you feel it. There are opportunities for you that you can take advantage of. But again, not all of us have that opportunity, or to be able to spot the opportunity and all of that. Because at times you're friends with powerful people, and some of us assume that it will be like that for years, not knowing that opportunity is just there, for that period. Because the man you know will probably leave office, and they will not tell you that, if you are told at that time,
I would have done
this for you, I would have done that for you, and all of that. So it depends on how each editor looks at what has been given to him, the opportunity that has been given to him, and all of that. So that explains that aspect.
So now, from writing, I don't want to use the word writing serious news, because news is news, whether you're writing celebrity news. It's all important. You're now writing about happenings, society.
You know, everything goes back to the what do you call the vision and the mission of the of City People. The whole idea is to mirror the lifestyles of people, celebrity people, those living in the city. That's how the name came about, City People, and all that. So we look at their lifestyle, politics, fashion, entertainment, and everything. The whole gamut of what they do and all of that. So I've always believed in that, and I felt, City People can do. So what we try to do every week is to report serious issue from a very soft perspective. You're talking of the budget. How does the budget affect a loaf of bread or affect your living your life the way it's, whether it's going to change it, that's what will come from a different angle. Of course, entertainment,
the budget affects it too.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. It affects every bit of it. But we need to break it down rather than just say, government has voted 3 trillion or something for the budget of 2021 and all of that. We'll break it down. How will this affect your life, as it were? So we always look at the even politics. We look at who are the personalities dominating the political space at any point in time, and all of that. So that's a bit, that's what gives it a bit of difference from what we were doing. At a point, all the papers and even the magazines had to soften up because people were no longer keen on too serious hardcore news. So everybody had to soften up. All the papers had to, like from Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, they had to soften up and get a lot more color, do more entertainment, do more fashion, do more lifestyle and all of that. I think
so. And the entertainment did take over at that time.
Yes.
Before we go into the more thing.
Yeah.
Tell us about we know you had several close calls.
Yeah.
Tell us about one that sticks out in your mind, one that, you know, you're just, because we know some of your colleagues that didn't make it, some that affected their health and what have you from being locked up and being.
I think I would just say that I was lucky. Because I know at that time that I was also one of the major targets of our friends in the
uniform
and all of that. Because they needed to know how we were coming out. We were not operating from our office. We were operating from underground. Some even said, oh, this guy, don't mind them. They're operating from American Embassy. People started coming up with theories.
There was no online then.
There was no online then. And we were coming out regularly. We didn't have a stable office. We had places we meet, and that's why all they did, if I was doing the time, they declared us wanted and all of that, but they still could not decode how we're doing it and all of that. And I just decided that I was also going to continue to do what I was doing and make sure that I reduced. So of course, home was no-go area.
You had to stay away from your family.
Yes, actually. Yes, and luckily I had what do you call them? My parents-in-law who took my kids and my wife, and there was nobody, no life in the place. So you would not even see me come near the house. And that one went on for about a year. So we would always go from one point to another. When we meet, even when we print, we would have a time of everybody should gather at a particular time, maybe like 1 a.m. We go to the printers, we print, and since it was just black and white, less than 30 minutes,
everybody disappears.
We distribute the magazine, we carry with our cars, and we go home like that. And that was how, so even the guys in the uniform, they were just like, where are these guys? They're not spirits and all that. Of course, when they couldn't now, they could, of course, they came up with all sorts of theories, or somebody's helping them, or they're not even printing in Nigeria, they're printing, and all of that. But of course, just to answer your own question, and there were times when we had close shaves with them, and of course, I remember one when the printing press, when they came, and of course, we just had to disguise like people who are helping the printers and all that, and we disappeared. The second time they stormed the office, I was actually there. I was the one they were looking for actually, and
they don't know who.
They don't know who I was. They didn't know what I looked like. Like now, when we have to be doing events, I don't know.
Yeah, to that one.
Yeah. So they came and they asked everybody to line up, to queue up, and then to show ID cards and all that. Of course, I collected someone's ID card, and they didn't look well. I skipped. So you know, at the point they were like, "What is this guy? What's he about?" And everything. It was like three or four times when they tried to close up on us and all that. I was always around, but somehow. They were just not
providence.
I will tell you one story that you said that they were at the printer's place. They didn't, I mean, they came to your office, they didn't know who you are, and you were able to. The same thing happened to me.
Okay.
When you said it, they rang the bell on my head.
Oh, I remember that story.
They came to Alagbado.
Okay.
I was wearing shorts. And again, so wearing short to them is like this one now.
This one now.
No, let's give the preamble. Okay. Actually, this will sound familiar to you, but the young ones.
Okay.
I believe one of our newscasters read the news and mispronounced the name of the head of state.
Okay.
You know, I mispronounced it and they took offense and they came with two truckloads of. I had just come from America and I was sitting in Kenny's office. I just saw everybody disappearing. America don't. And I'm sitting there, they walked in. Where's the general manager? Where's the news card? Me, I'm still looking for. Okay.
And I passed through them. I just walk. I say, wait, who are you? Okay, go.
The only person they arrested, I think, was Mr. Mr. Kisola reminds me of you. Kisola said, yes, I'm the general manager. Is there a problem? I said, hey, you are the general manager.
Let's go.
They didn't even ask for who wrote the news anymore. You follow. All of us.
It was a Friday.
Uh-huh. Once they get you on Friday, no bait till
Monday.
We all baggy, everybody jack money. When I realized that, wait a minute, these are our soldiers.
No, just.
Even Mr. Asi Amekra, I came here to buy. Tony Akechi, everybody, we don't climb fence. But of course, Dr. Percy came on Monday and sorted everything out. But precarious times, it just makes you, you realize how much your freedom is.
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah.
You know, people now just sit anywhere and tweet whatever they want. They write anything they want. They abuse. Why you abuse anybody without thinking of even consequences? We couldn't do that in those days.
Yeah.
I of course laugh when the end brutality and NSAS came.
Yeah.
And some of them were saying our generation killed them. We did all these things, and we did it under the gun.